Ladies and gentlemen, good afternoon. We are having a unique meeting with Cecilia Dean. Cecilia is one of the co-founders and one of those who have inspired Visionaire, the Visionaire magazine. Most of you know, some of you have seen, and it's something unique, something strange. Cecilia herself said it could be a tiny Swiss Switzerland. It's a small publishing house that makes a lot of difference, braving big corporations. And since Cecilia, or to be more precise, her magazine has been invited to take care of Cadillac House, which is in the center of Manhattan. Yes, well, today we are going to talk about art and commerce and how important, how it has been going on for quite a number of years. Cecilia is a very exciting presenter, and like many Russian presenters, she always takes the trouble to prepare herself, and it will be an exciting talk. She will say how commercial brands are integrating space, how commercial how commercial brands are developing. And well, I've started this, I've introduced the discussion with a brief word of introduction. I hope it will be very exciting. And then there will be a Q&A session. And if you are still alive after this talk is over, then Cecilia, I give the floor to you.
Thank you, Anton, for having me. Thank you, everyone, for being here. I'm very honored to be at Garage. I think it's an incredible institution. So I was going to brief you quickly on Visionaire and some things that we've been up to. And you know, Visionaire has its roots in publishing, and we really value creativity, and we want to offer a forum for people to be as creative as they possibly can be. And our roots are really in these publications. We have brought 25 with us for you to explore and experience yourself. But what we have also managed to do, which I think is quite rare, is to marry creativity with brand partners. And so these are a few of the big brands, the corporations that we have worked with in the past. I'm showing here a couple examples of issues of Visionaire and how they've incorporated a brand presence. So for instance, in the upper left corner, it's a deck of cards. So De Beers and the Diamond Information Center contacted Visionaire and wanted to do some sort of a project with us. So we came up with the idea of doing a deck of cards. And for the House of Diamonds, we had 13 incredible artists shoot millions of dollars worth of diamonds. And so that's how we incorporated diamonds into an issue of Visionaire. It's completely seamless. Next to that, on the right, is an issue that we did of flipbooks. And originally, that we came up with that idea when we were speaking to Sony PlayStation. They wanted to do an issue of Visionaire. And of course, we were so excited because we wanted to do a video game. And they said, no, we want to do something in print, which was very disappointing for us. But we decided to figure out how could we do moving image and publishing at the same time. So we came up with this idea of doing flipbooks. Flipbooks have been around for hundreds of years. There's nothing unique about them. But what was fun for us was we were able to contact very serious filmmakers like Baz Luhrmann and Spike Jonze and Wong Kar-wai to do 3 seconds of film for us. And that was a way for us to open our community. So instead of just working with artists and fashion photographers, we were now able to work with filmmakers. Below that issue, on the lower right, it's an issue called Rio. And it was actually partially sponsored by the city of Rio. They were advertising themselves and with a big fashion mall called Iguatemi. And the issue was all about celebrating the city of Rio, but also Brazil as a place, but also as a feeling and a concept. And we were able to work with many amazing Brazilian artists, as well as international artists, giving their interpretations about Brazil. What was very interesting about this issue was that it incorporated a stereoscope. And a stereoscope is the device that you find inside, and you put a slide into it, and you see it in 3D. And stereoscopes have actually been around since the mid-1800s. It was the main source of images from around the world before the advent of newspapers. And there's been so much technology in 3D, so for us it was quite fun to go back to the original analog 3D. But it's still very, very captivating. And we actually brought this issue with us so you can all see it for yourself. And the last issue is called Decades. And this was sponsored by a Japanese department store called Isetan. And they were celebrating their 120th anniversary and asked us for an idea. So we came up with the idea of portfolios by really great artists and photographers, and each one would pick a decade. So we did the 1880s all the way until 2000. I hope I'm not going too fast for the translator. Here are four more examples. On the upper left is an issue called Forever. And we were talking to a Japanese watch company, G-Shock, and their slogan is the toughest watch in the world. It's the indestructible watch. And we really loved this idea of indestructibility, because when you think of normal publishing, you know, ink on paper, obviously it's very destructible. It's not archival, very easy to destroy, they don't last. So we thought a really fun concept would be to do an issue that would be in itself indestructible. And so the entire issue is made out of metal. And we're still showing 10 beautiful images by amazing artists, but they happen to be pounded into metal or etched into metal, encased in a stainless steel case. And I think a lot of people questioned us, is this still publishing, right? There's no paper, there's no ink at this point. And we say, absolutely, this is publishing, because we are taking images and we're sharing them with a larger audience. And for us, that's really what publishing is about. On the upper right is an issue called Surprise. And Krug was the sponsor for this issue. They're a very high-end, awesome champagne company. And whenever you think of champagne, you think of parties, you think of, you know, like a surprise party. And we love this idea of pop. Obviously, pop is champagne. It's the sound that it makes when the cork comes out. And that led us to this idea of a pop-up book. So we did pop-ups, which again is something that's been around for many, many years. But we did it with incredibly serious artists like Andrea Skursky and Stephen Klein and Cai Kuo Cheng. And it was a really fun issue to do. And on the lower right is an issue that was sponsored by Lacoste. So we took very serious artists and featured their images on Lacoste polo shirts. And it really is about wearable art. And again, I think people can question whether this is publishing, but for us it absolutely is. And instead of your blank canvas being a white piece of paper, it happens to be a white polo shirt. And then the last issue on the lower left was a collaboration with Kid Robot, and it's a series of toys. And again, we're not dealing with a flat piece of paper, we're dealing with a 3D white plastic object. But for us, it's still about showing people different images. This was also a really interesting way for fashion designers to contribute to Visionaire, because they were all creating characters for their toys. So a lot of these issues we've brought with us, and hopefully you can see them and experience them later this evening. This is an issue, I highlighted this issue. It was done back in 1996. And it's called Fashion Special. It was actually our 18th issue. It came out 20 years ago. It's hard to believe. And it was before Louis Vuitton did fashion. It was before they hired Marc Jacobs. And they were, you know, very interested in getting into fashion. And we were working on this issue where we paired artists with fashion designers to create portfolios of images. And we asked, by fax, someone at Louis Vuitton if they would make the packaging for the issue. And they wrote back by fax, yes, we will. And 2 months later, we had boxes full of these custom-made cases. And it's an interesting story to think back on it now, because the whole relationship was so easy and it was so simple. There were no contracts, there were no terms. I feel like that simplicity is something of the past, and things are always just a little more complicated now. But since then, we've done two more issues with Louis Vuitton, which have been really great collaborations. And I think it's very interesting for them to align themselves with artists and other fashion designers. I thought it was a very smart move. And like all of our sponsors, they really have no idea what the contents are. They have no say in what the images or what any of the artists are doing. This is another example of an issue that we started and then contacted Tiffany's. This is called A Visionaire 38 Love, and it was actually our reaction to the 9/11 attacks that happened in New York City. And it was a very strange and devastating moment in our history. And really everyone was feeling this sadness, remorse, terror. And we really wanted to do something that tried to find the positive back in life again. And so when we started talking to all these artists, you know, the question was, what do you do for love? What do you do out of love? What do you love to do? And really trying to bring people back to the personal, back to what makes them happy. And we took all these submissions and we actually put them into vintage novels. So each issue is different. We had to find 4,000 vintage novels that were all approximately the same size, which you would think would be very easy in this digital age, but it was actually incredibly complicated. And so each one is a one of a kind. And then we asked Tiffany's if they would be a part of the issue. It's almost like if you think of love, you automatically think of Tiffany's. I don't know if that's the same in Russia, but in America, it's almost like a cliche. Like you always get like the Tiffany's, you know, wedding band. Obviously, we didn't mean it in a cliche kind of way. It was just seems so obvious. And sometimes, you know, we're actually very obvious people. We're not very subtle. And then we started doing little films to explain the issues of Visionaire, because as you can see, they're very, I wouldn't say they're complicated, but they do require participation. You have to open cases, untie ribbons, flip through books. You know, one issue you have to take out into the sunlight in order to understand it. You can taste issues, you smell issues, you touch issues. You know, we sort of require a lot from our reader. And so we started doing little films to explain them online. Visionaire really does not exist well online. And that really started us getting into film. And it also started getting us into public art. The issue that I actually just showed was number 64, it was called Art. And we asked celebrities to give us selfies, and then John Baldessari made them into artworks by adding color shapes to the selfies. And we wanted to offer this experience to a much wider audience, and so we did a public art installation at the Chrysler Building, which is a huge iconic building in Manhattan, and we reproduced John Baldessari's color shapes so that anybody could go up to them and take their own selfie with the color shape, and thereby participating in the issue. And the issue is actually sponsored by Samsung. And to me, this was sort of a perfect integration of Samsung product. They were promoting the Samsung Note 3, not 7 that blows up. And, you know, sort of the quality of the images that it takes. And then obviously we're playing off the whole selfie culture. You know, self-portraits have been around for thousands of years. But selfies it's a relatively new thing because it's all about using your digital equipment. It's all about social media. So, you know, as people are doing the selfies, you know, we're sort of recording the whole thing. I think it was like sort of the perfect integration of a big corporation, a big brand like Samsung, with a very creative publication like Visionaire. And this idea of these public art installations grew for our next issue of Visionaire, which was number 65, called Free. And we actually gave away the issue for free. Normally, issues cost hundreds of dollars, sometimes thousands of dollars per copy. And we know that we have a lot of enthusiastic fans and friends and supporters who simply can't afford what we do. And we thought this would be a beautiful gift to the community to give them an issue of Visionaire for free. But obviously, since it was free, we couldn't use any of our stores or distributors. We couldn't use any normal channels. So we did these huge public art installations where anyone from the public could come and take the issue. And we produced the issues as giant posters. And we did it in 3 different cities. Each city had 12 different posters by 12 different contemporary artists. Now, something like this would be absolutely impossible for us to do on our own. We require a corporate sponsor to help us. And this is where a company like Stella Artois came in. And they were wonderful because they were able to provide a budget so that we could produce all these posters. We did tens of thousands of posters, and to put on these huge public installations. And I think that's really where corporations become so crucial to the creative community. We couldn't have given this issue away for free had it not been for the corporate sponsorship. And this is sort of like, I just added this project in because I thought it was really fun. We did a collaboration with Gap. Gap is probably the extreme opposite of Visionaire. You know, Visionaire is very exclusive, it's limited, it's it's very art and fashion and niche, whereas Gap is mass. Like, it's t-shirts, it's cheap, it's inexpensive, it's mass produced. And I think the combination of those two extremes is very interesting. We really love doing sort of juxtaposing opposites. So what we did for them is we did four different collections of t-shirts for a total of 45. And we did 45 because Gap was celebrating its 45th anniversary. So this was a couple years ago. And we reproduced images from past issues of Visionaire onto Gap t-shirts and Gap sweatshirts. Now, for us, it was a huge experiment. Some people said, you can't do that. Don't ever do that. You can't associate Visionaire with a brand like Gap. And for us, we say, absolutely, we have to do it because it is so strange. It's such a strange marriage. So the next big experiment was, would the artists like to be on a $29.95 Gap t-shirt? And we were pleasantly surprised that practically every artist said yes, which is amazing. And so again, we're making this wearable art. And in one of the collections, which is on your lower left, it was called the Solar Collection. And if you wore the t-shirt indoors, it was black and white. And the moment you went outside under direct sunlight, it turned to color. And that required a lot of engineering. It exists, it's a technique that exists, but it hadn't been done on a sort of mass scale the way Gap produces their t-shirts. And again, something like that would have been impossible for us to do had it not been for like a big company like Gap's supporting it. And then that sort of leads me into film. So we started working in film. And film is really expensive. So you really need partners in order to do films. Even very simple films require a lot of people. It requires a lot of technology, time. And they're just inherently quite expensive. So we're absolutely dependent on brands to help us produce these films that we can share with a much broader audience. One of the reasons why we started film was precisely to reach a bigger audience. You know, Visionaire is done in such limited editions. You know, we're usually doing 1,000, maybe 1,500 copies. Our next issue that's out next month, we're only doing 200 copies. That means only 200 people in the world are ever going to have it. But for film, we can produce something and share it online, and it can live for a really long time. It can be shared. So we started this fashion series called One Look. It focuses on couture, and it was funded by Refinery29, which is a huge website. And it was it's been an incredible experience for us because we're learning to do film, but we're also learning how to document process, and we're reaching a much larger audience. And I actually brought one of the films so that we can watch it in its entirety. It's only 3 minutes long, so don't worry. And I think they're supposed to have sound. We're missing the sound. Oh, there it is. Thank you. I hope you enjoyed that. It was a really fun experience for us to work on a film like that. Obviously, it's an amazing piece for Dior. And I think what makes it such a strong film is that Dior gave us full access. We could shoot anywhere, anytime. They were very helpful telling us when very interesting things were going on. But they had no creative control. They couldn't tell us what had to be edited out or edited in. And I think because of their trust in us, they came out with a superior product in this film. And then, you know, it was funded by Refinery 29. Again, they had no say in the creative. We told them what we wanted to do. They said, here's the funding, just do it. And we posted it 12 hours after the show happened. And it's been shared by millions of people. So for us, sharing it with so many people is really thrilling, because we could never do that with an issue of Visionaire. It's impossible, except through the press. Maybe you can read about it. But in order to, the fact that we were able to create something and then share the creation is very interesting for us. And this year happens to be our 25th anniversary. So we've come out with a book, and we have the book here. It just released last week. And as an ongoing project, we asked young filmmakers and video artists to do what we call commercials. And we're using the word commercial in a very loose way. And the inspiration, oh, thank you, Anton. In a very loose way, it's not your typical advertisement. It's more like taking inspiration from an issue of Visionaire and then doing your own interpretation of it. It's the way we started Visionaire in print, we're now doing it with short film. And so I brought a couple of them to show to you, and we have them on display as well. But it's been a really fun exercise. The inspiration goes back to some very funny and creative commercials that were done back in the 60s and 70s. For instance, Andy Warhol did a Burger King commercial, and it's on YouTube, so you should look it up. It's very funny because it's basically Andy Warhol eating a hamburger. That's the entire commercial. But I think what's so interesting was that a big corporation like Burger King would do an artist collaboration like that. I think it's very forward thinking. It shows a huge amount of confidence with the brand. Another big inspiration was an Alka-Seltzer commercial done by Salvador Dali. And it's so weird and wacky. But again, I think it's a testament to how confident Alka-Seltzer was that they would do an artist commercial, which lives on to today. You know, you can see that on YouTube. You know, I think it's probably the only Alka-Seltzer commercial you would actually want to look at. I can't even think of any of the other commercials that they've done. And so that was a little bit the inspiration. So I think I brought three to look at. This was based on Visionaire 26 Fantasy, and that's the issue. You know, that issue was called Private, and it was about private moments of public people. And so the filmmaker, Tyler Ford, is doing the exact same thing, but in film, he wanted to show the private moments of Bella Hadid, who's a famous model. You know, at the same time, he was really into Bella Hadid. He wanted an excuse to be able to work with her, and so Visionaire was that excuse. And I really love the idea of artists using Visionaire as an excuse to explore their obsessions. And I think that's where Visionaire's place is in sort of the creative world. And the last one commercial that I'm showing is based on an issue that we did called Taste. And we actually brought that with us as well. And basically, you had to taste everything. Image, you know, we worked with artists who concepted the idea and then the visual for the idea and then what that idea tasted like. And so based on this idea of taste, the filmmaker wanted to follow Leonardo DiCaprio tasting things in all of his films in chronological order. I mean, I just think it's so creative. I mean, it's such a wacky idea. This is something a little bit different, but dovetails into what I'm going to talk about next. Is this idea of art and fashion and experience is really what Visionaire is all about. And we've done it thus far with publishing. But a few years ago, we started an exhibition called Move, which I curate with a fellow named David Coleman. And with this exhibition, we pair an artist with a performance artist. We pair a performance artist with a fashion designer to create an installation that requires audience participation. So it's literally art and fashion and experience. And so a couple of these on the lower left, this was a collaboration between a performance artist named Ryan McNamara and the fashion designer, Diane von Furstenberg. So you would enter his space, and you would change into a DVF wrap dress. And then you would go on set, and Ryan McNamara, the artist, would take photos of you in very specific poses. And then on the spot, while you're there in real time, he makes those poses into a pattern. And then with that pattern, you can order a DVF wrap dress with the pattern of you wearing a DVF wrap dress on it. And so you're really playing with the idea, obviously, of art, of fashion, experience, selfies, wearable art. I mean, the sort of the connotations can go endlessly, but it was a very fun experience. And we want to do a lot more of these. I'd really like to do it in Moscow, actually. On the upper right corner, that was an installation that was a collaboration between an artist named Rob Pruitt and Mark Jacobs. So you were instructed to walk down a green hallway. There were people ordering you what to do, how to act, and you weren't really sure exactly what you were doing and why, but when you exited the green hallway, you realized you were superimposed into the Marc Jacobs fashion show. And then that was streamed online, so you could download it, you could take photos of it and screenshots and share it with people. We like doing things that are very shareable and online friendly. These were a few more examples of these art, fashion, experience collaborations. And then that brings me to Cadillac House. Cadillac, which is a big American car company, moved its headquarters from Detroit to New York. And as part of the move, they opened up a space called Cadillac House. It's a big, huge, open space in downtown New York City. It's free and open to the public. It's actually not a showroom. You can't buy a car there. There's a cafe. There are multiple lounges, so you can work there. You just log on to their Wi-Fi, and you can have meetings there. You can book conference rooms there. It's all for free. They have a space called Retail Lab, which is a partnership with the Council for Fashion Designers of America, where they give a space to a young designer for 3 months so they can see what it's like to have a retail space without having to make the huge financial investment, which I think is a wonderful program. And then they have an exhibition area. And so they've hired Visionaire to program this exhibition space. And for us, it's been totally thrilling because, you know, we're used to working with an object. All of our thoughts and productions end up in an object that you can hold and buy. And now we have a space. And so we're creating experiences, but in a spatial environment. And, you know, it's an interesting place because it's not a gallery, which means there's no pressure to sell any of the work in there. It's not meant to sell anything. It's also not an established institution, so we can work with quite young and emerging and experimental artists. So for us, it's been a really thrilling experience to bring these sort of immersive fashion and art experiences to a public. I think what's also very interesting, and that goes for MOVE as well, is that you're dealing with a space. So in terms of editions of Visionaire, we're dealing with the brand within the object. For MOVE, the latest one I was talking about took place at Brookfield Place. It's actually a mall. And Cadillac House is a space. And I think what's interesting is that people aren't going to these spaces to encounter art. They're going for other reasons. They're going to shop or to eat. They're going to like work. And then to be sort of interfered with by art that they're not expecting is a really interesting scenario. And I feel like this day and age, there are so many places and things we go to and do, and you can kind of predict what it's going to be. A dinner is a dinner, gallery opening, a party. But I think there's something about spaces and performance art that is really mysterious. You have no idea what's going to happen to you, what you're going to see. And I think we like playing with that surprise element. So Cadillac House has been a very interesting foray for us. The current exhibition, which is actually closing on Friday, is the lower right. It's called Auto Portrait. And we actually bought a robot that is normally on an assembly line for car manufacturing, and its specialty is welding. And we reprogrammed this robot to do your portrait, and then you can keep your portrait. So I think there's a lot of very interesting conversations you can have about technology and art, and you know, what happens when a non-human is doing art? Is it still art? How are they interpreting you? How does a robot interpret you? I think there's many more discussions to have, but for what I think we thought was so clever about it, obviously too, is you're taking something from the car industry and you're making it into an art experience. And then I wanted to bring this along. Right before the auto portrait exhibition, we did an exhibition with Richard Avedon, who has passed away over 10 years ago. But he did an incredible series of commercials. This is advertisements for a Japanese brand called Junrope. And we exhibited them at Cadillac House. It was hugely popular. And I'm going to play this one for you, and then I'll talk about it a little bit afterwards.
Tell us about this movie you did. Well, the director wants his wife to sit me in it. And he told me. And his first line of direction to me was, just say the word, sister. Hey, like that. Ow. So I get off the plane, and my mother's there. She's got my four little sisters. And they woke up with placards that say, welcome home, lovely Lauren.
Hey, baby.
Okay.
There we go.
So Avedon had done four of these commercials. I think they're so amazing. They were done back in 1973. And, you know, I wanted to show it tonight because, you know, we're talking about brands and creativity and the marriage between the two. And I think it's so apropos that we're showing a straight up commercial at a museum at this point, which would just never have happened before. But now we're doing it. There's like a really funny fine line, and we want to play with that fine line. So thank you.
Thank you. So thank you very much, and I think it was one of the most, expressive from the presentation, and so well prepared, and you were so amazing, so thank you very much.
Thank you.
Yeah, and...
I take being at Garage very seriously.
Thank you. Of course, I want to mention that I didn't know that Leonardo DiCaprio made so many movies, so half of them I never saw and even doesn't know the name, so I need to check it. And
yeah, I think I've seen all of them. He does it's a lot of pills, pills and drinking.
Mm-hmm. That's why I think I didn't see it. I have a small question. I didn't prepare it before, but when you go through, and I thought, because I think it's a good question. Did you do something with Russian artists? It's the first question. And the second one, do you know that 2017 it will be 100 years of Russian Revolution? So maybe it's a good idea to make something about visionary about Russian Revolution, 100 years. And did any Russian company ask you for collaboration? I don't know, like Kalashnikov Corporation to present something, or maybe a Russian vodka a brand or something. So everything about Russia.
Yeah, well, you know, we have worked with some Russian vodka brands, but it's always been for a party. So I have such admiration for Moscow. I've been here several times. I think the art scene and the fashion scene, I'm wearing Walk of Shame, is really exciting here. I've known a really crazy Russian artist named Fyodor
Pavlov Andreyevich.
Yeah, he's crazy, but amazing genius. And we actually printed a beautiful photo of him in our free issue, which actually opens our book. And it's a photo of an 8-hour durational performance. But this, you know, I learned about some really amazing Russian artists today. There was a Paulina Canis.
Paulina Canis.
Yeah, which I was looking at her videos. They're so great and fun, and just there's so much to talk about. And this Olga
Kreuter.
Yeah, which I also thought was really, really interesting. And I've always been a big fan of AES plus F. I've never worked with them, but I... Do you know who I'm talking about?
I think they're really quite famous in Russia, so...
Oh, I think they're so cool. Yeah, well, I think they were the Russian Pavilion at Venice Biennale a few times ago. I think they're amazing. I'd love to work with them. You had a lot of questions in that one question. What?
Revolution.
And I think it would be amazing to do a Moscow issue or a Russian issue.
Wow.
Celebrating, I mean, I don't think the issue itself would celebrate the revolution, but it would be a time to come out with something because it would make sense. You know, I already have some ideas. And I think doing a move here would be so amazing to get international fashion designers and artists to pair up with Russian fashion designers and artists to do interactive experiences would be really awesome.
Okay, so
I would love to do more in Russia.
So let's do Moscow Russian issue.
Yeah.
Okay, deal.
Sounds good. I'm expensive though, sorry. It's gonna cost a lot of money.
We're not the poorest organization in the world, so I think we can do it. And we have sponsor Cadillac, so everything is good. My second question is not prepared too, so you didn't see it. When I start to think, and a lot of people in Russia, they think about Visionaire and about you, because you're not like first time in Moscow, and you already like made public talks and something, but it all, like usually when somebody talk about you, it's more about that you're like co-founder, publisher, ideologist, but I think like through the...
Ideologist, I like that. Sounds okay. Very intellectual.
I like how Cecilia like switching her perspective, and the question is that you're slightly moving from the like publisher when you start in 99, and now you're making movies, you're presenting exhibitions, you're like co-hosting huge like events which like everybody wants to come, and now you're not only like promoting, but you're like representing the space in the center of the New York, and like you're, I don't know, do everything. So now it's a question, what is it, Visionaire and yourself? Because if before it was like pop-up project, I don't know, magazine or something, now it became institution from my perspective. And you're like director of institution, which is like huge. And it's not question of the place or the number of people, but it's more about the energy and the quality. And you're doing like research for the future. You're switching from fashion to art, from art to technologies, like you did with this robot who's doing your portraits, but this is like a welding machine from the factory. And so you are like switching and changing, and how you're like, I don't know, think about yourself in this perspective, and what's your, I don't know, vision for the future of the Visionaire?
That was a really long question, Anton.
As always.
You know, you calling us an institution is, I was really taken aback when you said that. That's so strange and surprising. I don't think of ourselves as an institution. I guess I think of an institution as something that's very established and constant, and I feel like we're very malleable. We have a very small team. We're like 8 people, so that we can change direction. We can make decisions. You know, we can do everything like instantaneously. And, you know, we're based in New York City because we can get anything done in 24 hours. That's our logo. Anything done in 24 hours. But I think at the core to everything is this art, fashion, and experience. And it's not like we always understood that. It's only because we had to do this book and we had to go back and look at 25 years worth of materials and correspondence and press. And we were doing a series of interviews with a writer. And it was only then that we realized, like, oh, you know, the things that keep popping up are art, fashion, and experience. And I feel like everything that we do is still about art, fashion, experience. We're just using, like, different mediums, right? So publishing will always sort of be a core for us, but now we're doing it in film, now we do it in a space, now we do it in an exhibition. And what we like too is that everything is travelable. I guess that's another reason why institution for me is kind of a weird word, because that to me connotates it's in one place and does not move. It is established and people go to it. It doesn't go to others. And I feel like we're almost the opposite of an institution because we can travel. Everything we can do can be done anywhere. And it's not the same thing. It's always site specific, right? So issues are about a theme or a place, as in the Rio example. But MOVE is always site specific. It has to do with the place. It has to do with the people in the place. It has to do with the audience. And the same with film. And really everything that we do now. I don't know if I answered your question.
You answered my question, yeah. You said that you're anti-institution, that means it's your institution, which is good. And my next question, and I know like a lot of people, they have the same problem in garage, that's where start preparation for the openings, like in a year before the openings. And you, like in your interview, said the same, that's when you start the issue, you're already thinking about how to present it, what will be the party, who will attend this party, and how it will like go through the night or something. So can you like talk about more, because in your presentation it's not well understandable, but it's like a part of Visionaire, and how you think about this, how you work with it, and like what you're doing.
Right, the events.
The events.
Yeah, so since the very beginning we've always, we don't always have an event for an issue, but we very often do. And in the beginning, it was really just a way to say thank you to the artists. You know, we're always so grateful to everyone who participates in Visionaire, because we don't pay them. So it's really a labor of love if an artist participates. And so in the beginning, these parties were really about bringing all these people together and building community. We're very interested in building community and having human interaction. As we evolved, as in the example I gave for the John Baldessari installation at the Chrysler Building, the events have become more like manifestations of the issue, right? So the issue exists, but now you can sort of participate in the issue at the event. And that's also very important for us too. And then making that, taking that one step further, you know, we've always had events that are invitation only and quite exclusive and guest lists, et cetera, and we still do that. But the idea of then opening it up to the public is really thrilling for us. We want to reach many more people than our guest list. And so that has further opened us up, but it's also building community. And, you know, one of the reasons why we did the flipbook issue, which was with all the filmmakers, was because we wanted to reach that community. We've done an issue that was all sound related so that we could talk to the sound community. So we're constantly trying to build our communities. And a lot of times the event is the one time that all these people can get together. And sometimes it's the first time I'm meeting an artist who I've been talking to or emailing for months and months and pleading with them and thanking them and screaming at them. I don't ever scream at anyone. But sometimes the party is the first time I meet them in real life. And so they're quite important for us. But we only want to do an event when it really makes sense.
Okay, you said about artists, and one of the questions which we already started to talk with you before the speech, that did any artists said no to you when you like invited him to, like, to collaborate for like one issue with some brand? And I don't know how it looks like, because like of course 99, like 91, 90s, you was not like so like big like a brand and everything, but now Visionaire is a huge brand, and I think a lot of artists like, it's like they should be proud to take part in it, but still, I think a lot of artists, which like more radical, left position or something, they are not like agree to collaborate. So did somebody said no to you, and I don't know why and how?
You know, no one specifically comes to mind, but Anton, people say no to me all the time, if you can believe it.
It's strange.
Brands, artists, like, yeah, a lot of people say no, so you have to find the people that are going to say yes. Or sometimes I reject their no, and I keep pushing and pushing and pushing. And sometimes that ends up being a yes, and a lot of times it's still a no.
Okay, and about brands, so how are you choosing brands? Because, of course, they sometimes say no, but I'm sure that a lot of brands want to collaborate with you, but maybe you're not sure that you want to collaborate. And how about the strategy? Should it be like a huge brand, or it's like, should be an artistic statement inside, and like artistic director should be your friend, or like a cool guy, or collaborate with that, I don't know. How are you choosing this, and how this story working for the Visionaire?
We like to collaborate with brands that have a really strong identity, you know, and we've collaborated with Hermes, you know, the height of exclusivity and luxury, but we've also collaborated with Gap. We did an issue with Gap along with the t-shirts. You know, obviously not exclusive or luxury, they're a mass brand, but both of those companies have such a strong identity, and that's what makes it interesting for us. Because when we collaborate with a brand, we really want to use them as a source of inspiration. You know, I think the metal issue in G-Shock is a really good example. We wouldn't have come up with this indestructible issue of Visionaire made out of stainless steel had not the brand said, we're the indestructible watch. You know, and I, you know, we love the idea of selfies. Well, to be honest, I hate the idea of selfies. But for the issue, it was really interesting. And to make it into art with John Baldessari was incredibly interesting, and that was his idea to do selfies. I thought it was totally genius. But then there are some companies that want to work with us, but we can't come up with a good idea. And if we can't come up with a good idea that makes sense, you know, I don't want to take their money. I don't want to do an issue and someone looks at it and then they're like, oh, but why did such and such brand do this? That makes no sense. To me, that would be total failure, right? You want to do a collaboration with a brand, and it's like, oh, of course that makes sense. Of course it's Louis Vuitton or Hermes or Gap or Samsung. So, yeah, and then there's plenty of companies that we would love to work with. But, you know, if a big brand doesn't know Visionaire, it's very hard to convince them to do a Visionaire. Because they're expensive and, you know, they're very ambitious and they're labor intensive, and it's hard to convince someone to do it. So a lot of times the companies will come to us, and then it's a much easier situation.
You answered like to my next questions, which is good, so other people have a chance to ask you a question. But I always think like an institution have the same problem, so you should be like between like the famous artists, young artists, unpopular artists from different regions which nobody knows, and you always should be like at the same time strong in your position, but enough popular to people enjoy it. And I think the same problem for Visionaire, so you should like bring big names artists to the collaboration with the brand, but at the same time present something new which will be interesting for the people who are interested in art, or like in already collecting your Visionaire now for years, for, I don't know, 20 years. And this is a question, how you combine this and how you find this border between how many like famous artists, like not famous, young artists, and how you're working with it to do it the same, it's like a strong every issue, but at the same time quite popular so people want to buy it.
You know, it's difficult to strike that balance. And a lot of times it depends on how many artists we can work with. So for instance, we did an issue with Gap, actually. So this is about 11 years ago. And it was right when everyone had email already, but social media did not exist. I know a lot of you can't even imagine, but social media did not exist yet. But everyone had email, and everybody carried a digital point and click camera. Just everyone had one. And so you would take photos all the time, and you could download a photo and send it to one person at a time. You couldn't upload it and share it with millions of people. So for an issue like that, we combined very famous artists with completely unknown people, and some people weren't even artists. And we sent a chain email letter all around the world, and we asked people to send us an image of what life was like in their part of the world. And so we got thousands and thousands of submissions, and we printed a book of 250 of these images. And, you know, everyone got a full page. So you had a Mario Testino with a full page, you know, next to some young Indian kid taking a photo of his grandmother. facing it. And it was very thrilling. And I think the established artists loved it. They loved being with like all the young kids. And of course the young kids like freaked out because they're in a book with Nan Golden. But on the flip side, we're launching our next issue called Ritual, and I can only work with three artists. And unfortunately, well, fortunately or unfortunately, the names of the artist is what's going to sell this issue. Even though the issue is really great, even if it weren't these names, but these names are the things that are going to get the press and it's going to drive the sales. You know, so we're working with Barbara Kruger, Maurizio Cattelan, and Bruce Weber. They're all huge names. I don't have room to include emerging artists in that issue. So I think what we want to do is for the next issue, open it up, and so that we can include emerging along with established. But it's always a balance from issue to issue.
Okay, and my last question. So, as we understand, like from your talk, that Cadillac is a good brand which you should collaborate, and you first time start to like work with it like in a long term position. And as I know, you already start to future plans for 2017. So, can you talk about more about Cadillac, about the why you choose it like a culture brand or historical brand? Because we had the same talk with Robert Longa, which show we have, and he said that his first love affair was in his father Cadillac, so that's why he's still like so like this Cadillac and everything. And what's about you and how you think about this brand and the collaboration with like arts and like technology, like you did with this portrait thing?
Yeah. You know, I think Cadillac has been a great brand to work with, and I think this move that they did in New York City by opening up the space is a very different, very bold, very daring move. It's not an obvious strategy. So I think it's a really innovative strategy. The way to reach an audience is through a physical space. You know, I think the audience today is so smart and they're so savvy. They understand what paid advertising is. And I think brands have the challenge to talk to an audience and a new audience by doing very different activations. And I think by opening a space that's free and open to the public, by having Visionaire, which is, you know, we're pretty extreme opposites of Cadillac, to be brave enough to have us curate their space, I think is very daring of them. But I think it's all going to pay off for Cadillac. I think the amount of people that are talking about it, the press that they're getting, it's talks about a whole lifestyle and an entire identity. It's not just focusing on the product of the car. And I think that's what companies need to do. We're not so much just object-driven anymore. We're like idea driven, like we're all ideological on some level. And I think that's what's gonna make those connections. I love, you know, you're talking about Robert Longo's connection with Cadillac. It's through like a very beautiful and important moving memory of his. And I think that's what brands need to try to accomplish, like incredible experiences which become incredible memories, and that's what starts a relationship with a brand on a very profound level, which I think is a very new thing. I don't think that's been a common thing of the past.
But I think now everybody should start to do, because old-fashioned advertise not working anymore.
I agree.
So we're moving to the next stage and to the next like, century of advertise.
Yeah, and I think it'll be very interesting to see what happens.
Okay.
Well, first of all, many thanks for such an insightful talk. It's very useful and inspiring. My question is kind of a continuation of this most recent discussion about brands and arts. So what do you think is most important for brands' successful collaboration with the arts sphere? And are you seeing any changes, any trends in the way brands are now approaching arts and the way they collaborate?
Well, I think a lot of brands have, there's a tradition of brands supporting institutions. Like every time I go to a show at a museum, like you see all the sponsors that have made that show happen. And that's really important. I think it's very important for brands to give back and to financially allow the dissemination of very creative work and art to a public. I think it's crucial. So I'm hoping that brands will do more of this. But I think there are definitely ways of doing even more interesting activations than simply putting their logo on a wall, which I still think is very important. So I don't think anyone should stop doing that. I think that's crucial. But I think there's ways that we can get even more creative with that. And I think my MOVE project was super creative. I mean, I don't think anyone realized that the mall had funded the whole thing. It's a bunch of people going to a shopping center thinking that they're gonna buy clothes and have a bite of lunch, and like suddenly like they're making patterns of themselves. It's weird and wacky. And I think the more unexpected activations we can come up with, the more exciting it's going to be. And I think it'll just entertain all of us highly. And I think it's great for the brands also.
Hello, I've got one question. How does the brands work with the artists? Do they sometimes want to change anything, or they tell like, no, this doesn't go with our brand? Or it's you who are working with them?
You know, I think it's quite important to keep the brands separate from the artists, and me or the visionaire entity acts as the go-between. I think collaborations with artists work best when artists are allowed to do whatever they want. So for Visionaire, we give very basic parameters. They need to know, like, what's the format? What's the deadline? You know, some things are impossible for us to do, but pretty much we can do a lot of things. And then the artist goes off and does what they do best. And no one should really meddle in the creative process. I absolutely strongly believe that. And I think for the brand, they have to trust the creative. The brand is there to support the creative. They should not meddle in the creative. You know, just the way I wouldn't try to tell the brand how to make their product, they shouldn't tell the artist how to create their images. And I think when you can make that separation and everyone is secure enough to operate that way, that's when you get your absolute best results. It's difficult for the brands, but
your result is good.
Yeah, well, you just have to work with the brands and just make sure that they trust you and you're looking out for them. You know, for us, we work with sponsors all the time. We want them to be happy. We don't want to do an issue and they hate it and never work with us again. Like, we want everyone to be happy, the brands and the artists, because our relationships with these people is gold for us. Like, that's what keeps us doing this for 25 years. So the huge part of our job is to make sure that everyone is secure and happy and getting what they need out of the relationship.
Спасибо, Cecilia. Спасибо, Белов.